Hi there, I'm Jim Zirin. Welcome to Conversations in the Digital Age. With the focus on the presidential election these days, Americans may have lost sight on where we are headed in the Middle East. The controversial Iran nuclear deal appears to have miffed our two traditional Mideast allies, Israel and Saudi Arabia. And President Obama's recent trip to Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, does not seem to have advanced the ball. In addition, after more than a decade, there are still U.S. troops in Iraq now helping to fight ISIS. Are we tilting towards Iran and a new diplomatic revolution? Or will we continue to emphasize a Saudi relationship that has existed since the 1930s with the discovery of oil near the Arabian Gulf? With us is Vali Nasr, who served the nation as a close advisor to the late diplomat Richard Holbrooke on Afghanistan and Pakistan. Vali is the dean of the School of Advanced International Studies at Johns Hopkins. His latest best-selling book, The Shia Revival, How Conflicts Within Islam Will Shape the Future, is required reading for those seeking an enlarged understanding of conflict in the Middle East. Vali Nasr, we're delighted to have you with us.
To be with you.
Now, talk to us a little bit about this famous meeting in Riyadh between Obama and King Salman. It was supposed to clear the air. What was the air that needed to be cleared, and did it succeed?
Well, the meeting was scheduled a while back when originally, a year ago, the administration invited rulers from the Persian Gulf region to come to Camp David in order for the president to have an opportunity to explain the Iran nuclear deal to them. At Camp David, the GCC leaders invited him to attend their next formal GCC meeting in the region, and this meeting was in Riyadh. So this was basically a follow-up meeting to the original reassurance exercise in Camp David.
And for our viewers, GCC is Gulf
Cooperation Council, which is basically the little emirates around the Persian Gulf plus Saudi Arabia. There was not a big agenda for the meeting other than that what was promised at Camp David would be reiterated and perhaps new military deals would be signed. It would be more of a gesture of American commitment. The problem was that before the president went to Riyadh, there was an interview was published in the Atlantic monthly with Jeff Goldberg and the president, in which the president referred to Saudi Arabia as a free rider, accused Saudi Arabia of stoking extremism around the world, and basically said Saudi Arabia has to learn to share the region with Iran. I mean, these were not things that the Saudis wanted to hear, that their status as an ally was being diminished, not only vis-a-vis Iran, but they were being called free riders. So the president basically arrived in Riyadh with already the air having turned frosty in relations with the Saudis. So not much came out of that meeting, really.
Well, stoking the flames or perhaps just increasing the frosty nature of the relationship, Donald Trump during the campaign said we should withhold all military assistance from Saudi Arabia unless they're willing to pay for it. So that certainly didn't help the relationship, did it?
Well, there's something bigger going on than just the Iran nuclear deal that probably troubles the Saudis. One is that there's now a perception among Americans across the board that they no longer need Saudi oil, that the United States has by and large become energy independent, and therefore we really don't need to treat Saudi Arabia the way we did before. Secondly, with the attacks in San Bernardino, in Paris, in Brussels, the issue of extremist Islam in the manner in which we confronted after 9/11 has been revived, and that always puts Saudi Arabia in line of fire as a country that is tolerant of, if not actually promoting, extremism around the world.
Plus their possible involvement in 9/11 with the famous 48 pages and intimation anyway, that with 15 of the 19 hijackers with Saudis and possible involvement of officials of the Saudi government.
Well, you know, that was also an issue after 9/11. But the fact that after 9/11, the administration, the Congress, everybody saw it fit not to address the issue then, but rather now they want to open it up, is suggestive of that bigger problem the Saudis have, which is that the Americans now feel less dependent on Saudi Arabia and find it much easier to criticize Saudi Arabia, to attack Saudi Arabia, to threaten to reveal closed documents. All of this is problematic for the Saudis. So basically the idea that they're losing United States to Iran is part of the larger problem that the Saudis feel that the U.S. no longer values Saudi Arabia as a strategic partner in a manner that it has done for most of the past three decades.
Well, how much can they really complain about a tilt toward Iran? I mean, their military budget is something like $85 billion. Iran's is about $15 billion. We certainly have been arming the Saudis and giving them whatever weaponry they ask for.
Well, that's all true, and that ameliorates the disappointment to some extent. But the larger issue is not that we're necessarily tilting towards Iran. We're rather tilting away from the notion that there will be a tight alliance between U.S. and Saudi Arabia around absolute containment of Iran. So by saying that, you know, we think we can talk to these people about a few things and maybe even get an agreement, is already a huge shift from what the Saudis were used to with the U.S., where we didn't talk to Iran, they didn't talk to Iran, and we were as thick as thieves when it came to containing Iran. So now that's no longer there. As much as arms you might give them, it doesn't change the fact that U.S. now has a different theory of the case about handling Iran than they do. And they're not worried about right now, I think, even though they say they're concerned about Yemen and Syria and Iranian bad behavior. They're more probably worried that if the Iran nuclear deal does not end here, that somehow 10 years down the road, there will be many other deals, and maybe Iran will begin coming back into the region. And then essentially Saudi Arabia may confront the same problem that Japan or Philippines encountered after China fully integrated into the global economy. So a sort of a regional behemoth that you can no longer demand to be excluded from the region because it supports terrorism, builds nuclear technology, and has bad behavior. Iran with good behavior could begin to elbow its way around the region much more effectively than Iran with bad behavior.
Well, of course, there is a sectarian divide between the Saudis and the Iranians. The Iranians are Shia, the Saudis are Sunni. The Saudis recently executed a Shia cleric, which was an extraordinary action. Is there any hope of these two countries getting together, perhaps in some sort of mutual security arrangement involving the region?
Well, we hope that they will see that as a wise course of action. But I think currently they are engaged in a kind of regional rivalry, which is not alien to us. It happened in Europe between Germany and France, or it happened in Asia between different countries. You have two countries who see their interests as somewhat mutually exclusive right now. The rest of the Middle East is in a free fall. Each of them sees an opportunity to expand its influence at the cost of the other one and is trying to protect what it has from encroachments from the other side. So in this kind of a context, the United States, religious divisions, rhetoric, you know, all of these become fair game. But at the core of it, you have two countries who basically each wants to be seen as the top dog in the Middle East and wants to wield influence and sees the other one as an obstacle to its exercise of power.
Recently, we stated we were going to halt the sales of cluster bombs to the Saudis, which they've been using in Yemen against largely Shia populations. And does this indicate really that we're kind of leaving them, that we may be cutting them loose or leaving them high and dry?
Well, I mean, first of all, the use of cluster bombs is problematic. In other words, any time that any ally of the United States, which has purchased weapons from the United States, use them in a manner that could be contravening international law or have a reputation or legal risk for the United States, it's a problem. Now, the U.S. probably at the beginning tried to manage the Saudi use of cluster bombs quietly, But increasingly, there's now evidence from varieties of international organizations that doesn't allow the United States to say, well, this is not happening. So the United States has to criticize Saudi Arabia, and perhaps is trying to use the threat of not selling any further cluster bombs or criticizing Saudi Arabia publicly as a way of influencing the manner in which Saudi Arabia conducts the war in Yemen. You know, Yemen is the first time we've seen Saudi Arabia at war in this manner. And some of the way in which it is conducted the war makes us uncomfortable. It has hit too many civilian targets. Its air campaign has not been as accurate as it was supposed to be. There's too much collateral damage, and is laying waste to a country which is already infested with Al-Qaeda. And if Yemen becomes yet another failed state, which looks like to be the case, you know, that means yet another home for ISIS and Al-Qaeda, and yet another headache for the United States, that's bigger than it's been the case. So the U.S. has been uncomfortable with the fact that the Saudi war has not been clinical, has not been accurate, has been indiscriminate, has had too much civilian cost, and that Saudis don't have an exit strategy of how do they get out and how they put Yemen back together. So the United States is getting a bit nervous, and it's beginning to express that nervousness.
Let's just move to the Iran deal for a moment. Was this a good deal for the United States? Was it a good deal for Iran? Iran seems to have weakened their hold in the region by giving up their nuclear program. In exchange, the United States gave up sanctions, and there's a lot of pushback in the United States in moving from a sanctions world to a sanctions-free world. How is that going to play out?
Well, generally, I think it was a good deal for the United States because the U.S. used the sanctions very effectively to get the Iranians to the table and get the Iranians to agree to things that they have never done before. So in effect, Iran mothballed its nuclear program for a period of 15 years in terms of enrichment, but beyond that in terms of broader nuclear activity. It has dismantled its plutonium facilities. It has done a lot of things that we didn't want them to be doing. And yes, although this is not permanent, it does provide the world with a 15-year to 20-year time period that we know Iran is not doing the kind of nuclear activity that worried us. Even generals and security officials in Israel, not the government, but the security officials think it's a good deal that it has relieved a lot of worry from Israel, at least for a period of time. And it is a good deal because actually we're seeing that the Iranians are very frustrated in the sense that they're not getting the economic dividends that they thought they would get out of the deal, and that it has not materially improved Iran's role in the region. In fact, one of the consequences of the deal has been that the United States has been giving tens of billions of dollars of weaponry to UAE, Kuwait, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Israel. So you have a situation in which Iran gave up one big strategic toy, hasn't got anything in return, but whereas all of its competitors have now been armed further to the teeth. So regardless of the complaining people do, at the military level at least, the Arabs are now better armed than before the deal, and Iran has a lesser leverage than it had before the deal. So all in all, it is a good deal. At least right now, it's a good deal. But obviously, this deal has to survive. The Iranians has to stick with it. The United States has to stick with it. If at the end of 15 years, we look back and see that Iran actually did everything it said in the 15 years, and the U.S. said everything it did in 15 years, then it would have been a successful deal. But in the very short run, it allowed the United States to solve a problem that, frankly, it had no other way of solving. Sanctions by themselves would not have taken the nuclear program away, and war was not really an option. So the United States did get to protect the region from a nuclear scenario for a significant amount of time.
But in a period of 3 or 4 years, the Iranians under the deal are permitted to have missiles, which they could use to strike their neighbors if they wanted to. I mean, how do we prevent them from doing that unless we impose more sanctions?
Well, whenever you do negotiations, you can't have mission creep. You can't start by saying, well, I'm going to negotiate over this cup. And then as soon as the cup is negotiated over, you say, well, we didn't talk about the paper. The reality is that the missiles were not part of the deal. Terrorism was not part of the deal. Human rights and democracy were not part of the deal. The deal was singularly around Iran's nuclear program. That's largely because the rest of the P5+1, the other four permanent members of the United Nations plus Germany, had not agreed to solving all of Iran's problems under negotiation, but only its nuclear deal. So the deal is successful because it dealt with what it was supposed to deal with. But there are other aspects of issues with Iran. There's a missile program. There's cyber attacks that come from Iran. There is terrorism issues that come from Iran.
Well, the State Department just reported that Iran is the number one state supporter of terrorism in the world. When you think of ISIS, you think of Al-Qaeda, and you say number one on the hit parade is Iran. So what are we doing about that?
Well, Iran is a major supporter because of Hezbollah and other militias, but it cannot be blamed for the largest terrorism problem that confronts the U.S. and Europe, which is ISIS and Al-Qaeda, which has its source in the Sunni world, not in Iran's Shia world. But the reality of it is that there has to be other deals that deal with Iran's missile technology or terrorism or human rights. And those may come if your nuclear deal is successful, then you go to the next deal and you talk to the Iranians about their missiles. So, but in the current context of the Middle East, where the Saudis and UAE and other Gulf countries are building their military arsenal, and Iran does not have a way in which to assert its strategic objective in the region, it is doubling down on the missile program. And I don't see that being resolved unless the relations between Iran and its Arab neighbors improve, where neither side sees the necessity to be investing so much in military technology.
Let's just look at some of the interests which we may share with Iran, perhaps because of the sectarian divide. Iran is opposed to ISIS, which is mm-hmm. Sunni, and opposed to ISIS in Iraq. They're fighting alongside with us in Iraq and certainly in trying to take Fallujah, a Sunni city, and wrest its control from ISIS, and possibly if there's an invasion of Mosul. So we share an interest there, and we share interests in Syria, where ISIS also has a foothold. About half of the ISIS fighters are in Syria, maybe 20,000, and half in Iraq. So isn't there ground there for engagement and getting together and trying to solve some of the problems of terror in the Middle East?
Well, it has been. There's no doubt that if Iranians had not quickly responded to ISIS, that the Kurdish region of Iraq and Baghdad would have probably fallen to ISIS very early on, because the Iraqi army had completely collapsed and there were no U.S. troops on the ground. If anything, Iran provided the time for the United States to stand up a new Iraqi army that's now back in the fighting. But still, most of the fighting on the ground against ISIS is done by militias supported and trained by Revolutionary Guards. And there have been times where air support has come from the United States over militias backed by the Revolutionary Guards.
Revolutionary Guards being Iranian.
Iranian Revolutionary yes. Guards. So this is a very paradoxical situation where our main allies in the region are either not engaged at all in the fight against ISIS or generally don't see ISIS as the biggest threat. So Saudi Arabia or Qatar think in Syria, Assad is the bigger problem, not ISIS. Turkey thinks Assad is the bigger problem, not ISIS. The Europeans, I don't think any longer think that Assad is the bigger problem. Assad is a huge problem, but it's not the problem of ISIS is now problem of ISIS. And therefore we're not on the same page with them. But there is a big gap between sharing interests and converting to those shared interests to actually a pathway forward towards building better relations together. And so Iran and the United States have still a lot of work to do before they would be on a positive path together. So the nuclear deal was a big win because the two had never actually negotiated directly and never had signed on to anything directly. So that's a big win. The fact that they're fighting in Iraq on the same side and potentially in Syria on the same side is positive. But these by themselves don't change the character of the Iranian regime. They by themselves don't change the character of Iran's foreign policy. Because what you said, you could equally well be saying this to the supreme leader in Iran. You could say, well, you just signed a nuclear deal with the U.S. and isn't the U.S. also helping you in Iraq? And isn't the U.S. now helping you in Syria, so why don't you change your policy towards the United States and be a lot friendlier?
And he says, I'll think about it.
Well, absolutely. He's going to say, perhaps in a moment of truth, he's going to say, we have 40 years of hostility. I don't trust them. And also the change is a very big change, and I can't do it overnight. But these are better steps than had existed in the past. There are things essentially a challenge to build on, but they by themselves don't solve the problem.
Well, now, what about Israel, Vali? We saw a time where the Iranian leader, non-religious leader, Ahmadinejad, said that he wanted to wipe Israel off the face of the map. Netanyahu said Iran is an existential threat to Israel. Now they seem to have moved off that position. Do you see? Meanwhile, Israel seems to have forged a closer relationship with Saudi Arabia. They're cooperating with them on the bridge to Egypt. They are meeting with them. They certainly don't have full diplomatic relations, but they seem to be talking a great deal. So do you see a reconfiguration there of interests?
Yes, this is going to be a fluid picture for some time, largely because, you know, Iran, Israel, Saudi Arabia's view of one another is not necessarily personal. It has to do with how their interests configure in the region. Iran's animus towards Israel has always been peculiar because Iran is not Arab. And often it has...
And it's not a neighbor.
And it's not a neighbor and it doesn't have a territorial dispute. And even as we speak, still Iran has the second largest Jewish community in the Middle East after Israel. And the reality is that Iran's animosity towards Israel was always because Iran wanted to curry favor with the Arab public. Because being popular on the Arab street always mattered to Iranians a lot. And they figured that they're Persian, not Arab, and they're Shia, not Sunni. So the only way to curry favor with the Arabs was to be better at the Palestinian issue than the Arabs themselves. So
more royalist than the king.
More royalist than the king. So there was an Arab world to compete over, right? Now that Arab world is no longer there, and that Arab world has turned very hostile towards Iran because of the sectarian issue. It remains to be seen going forward whether Iran will continue to try to be more royal than the king, or maybe it will begin to gradually recalibrate its position. Similarly, Saudi Arabia has viewed Iran as the biggest strategic threat because of the country's size, because of its nuclear capability, because of its ability to project power right on Israel's border through Hamas and Hezbollah, and therefore has always identified Iran as the force to remain focused on. You know, the other Arab countries can be political nuisances, but they're not really a military threat to Israel. So the Israelis have reacted to this Iranian threat. Now, Israel is trying to ally itself with the Arab countries in order to contain Iran. But, you know, potentially down the road, if Iran begins to shift its position, Israel may change its position as well. I think, you know, because the heart of the Middle East has collapsed, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, Egypt, you have even low oil prices, all of these issues. I think everybody's looking at the map, and after several decades of very firm stability where everybody knew where they stood and what the rules of the game were, everybody's trying to figure out how they're going to play this and what might be coming next. I mean, nobody knows what's going to emerge in Syria and Iraq once the dust settles. And it may very well be that Iran and Israel may find themselves in a very different place trying to manage their affairs in Syria and Iraq than where they are now, or Iran and Saudi Arabia may begin to arrive at certain common ground, and then the Saudis no longer see any need to work with Israel. And then there's always a black swan event. If there is a major Palestinian intifada all of a sudden, which we're seeing at times threatened, that might make it very difficult for the Saudis to have any kind of a relationship with Israel.
If you talk to Israelis, they'll say, well, they're not so worried about ISIS, they're not so worried about Al-Qaeda or even Hezbollah or Hamas, because they're just terrorist organizations. Mm-hmm. What they're worried about is a state that's hostile to them, and the only state in the Middle East that's really hostile to them is Iran. They're a member of the international community, and they're going to have missiles. One day they may have nuclear weapons again. So what do they do about that?
Well, that's absolutely correct. And but at the same time, if you're sitting in Iran, you also realize so does Israel have missiles. and it has capability, and it has ability to build a computer worm that can bring down Iran's nuclear program. But the question is, you know, Iran once decided that it no longer can deal with the United States in a confrontational manner, and at least it has to go to the negotiating table and try to cut its losses and arrive at a more manageable situation.
So, Vali Nasr, I have a question for you.
Sure.
And the question is, do you believe that U.S. foreign policy will increasingly tilt toward Iran and away from Saudi Arabia?
Not immediately. I think the U.S. tilt away from Saudi Arabia does not have to do with the U.S.'s tilt towards Iran. This is not sort of the other side of the coin. I think tilting away from Saudi Arabia has to do with America's perception of energy independence, with certain frustration with Saudi Arabia's support of extremism, with proof that Saudi Arabia on its own cannot deliver in Syria, in Iraq, cannot manage a war in Yemen, and that Saudi Arabia has become somewhat of a headache for the United States in these particular arenas. Now the tilt towards Iran is right now very limited to essentially allowing the United States to manage the nuclear program. These things are not necessarily one or the other.
A limited tilt toward Iran. Vali Nasr, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Coming by. And thank you for coming by. Tune in next week for more conversations in the digital age. I'm Jim Zirin. Take care and all the best.